Thanks for your attention during this Superfly presentation on potentiometry. Potentiometry is an application of electrochemistry, or using electrodes to measure voltages that provide chemical information. More specifically, the measurement represents the difference in potential between two electrodes. This lab has two objectives: to determine the unknown concentration of cerium in a sample, and also to determine the potentials of the half-reactions associated with this experiment. To make these measurements, you'll be using a potentiometer like the one shown here. Whatever equipment you're using, it's important to know its capabilities and limitations. For example, the potentiometer can only measure plus or minus 2 volts, with a resolution of 0.1 millivolts. If you try to measure something outside the range, you'll see this error on the display, which also occurs if the electrodes are out of the solution, so don't be alarmed if you see that. Since we're measuring an unknown, we'll need a reference or a control. We could use a standard hydrogen electrode, but what is that? A standard hydrogen electrode is a reference electrode that would represent one half of a potential measurement. Here's a diagram of how it works. A good thing about an SHE is that its contribution to the potential measurement is 0 volts. Looking closer, we see that this isn't a very convenient half cell. It uses concentrated acid, requires a constant supply of hydrogen, and uses an expensive platinum plate where the half reactions occur. Fortunately, there are alternatives. One alternative is the saturated calomel electrode, and here's the half reaction associated with it. Now let's examine the parts. The core of the device is a small platinum wire. There's a small amount of mercury and mercury 1 chloride, or calomel, in contact with the platinum wire. Those chemicals are all contained within a glass tube, and a fibrous material keeps the calomel inside the tube. A second glass tube encloses the first. This outer glass tube is filled with saturated potassium chloride so that the concentration will remain constant. Note the solid at the bottom to keep the solution saturated. A small amount of saturated solution leaks out through a ceramic frit at the bottom. This is how conductivity with the solution is established, while keeping the solid KCl inside the electrode. Note that the vent must be open to allow air into the electrode for that small amount of solution to leak out the bottom. Let's say you wanted to analyze an unknown iron solution. The line notation for an SCE against the iron half reaction is shown below the beaker. Let's put the SCE in the solution. Remember that the potential contribution was about 0.24 volts for an SCE. Keep in mind that this value assumes 298 Kelvin and that the value varies slightly with temperature. A potentiometer needs both electrodes to measure a potential difference, so we'll next add a platinum wire as the working electrode. Remember that since the contribution to the potential from the reference electrode is constant, any changes at the potentiometer are due to fluctuations in the iron concentration. The measurements made by the meter represent the potential difference between the working and reference electrodes. This experiment involves two half reactions: cerium-4, which can be reduced at the working electrode, and iron-2, which is oxidized at the same location. Both of these half reactions are happening at the working electrode. Forgetting to correct for the fact that the reference electrode has a non-zero value is a common mistake. Let me explain using a number line. The units of this number line will be potential. Let's say we're working with copper, which has a half potential of 0.339 volts, and we're using a standard hydrogen electrode that has a potential contribution of 0 volts. Determining the difference in potential is easy. Just subtract by 0. Our meter would read 0.339 volts. Since using an SHE isn't convenient, we're going to use an SCE, which has a non-zero potential. So now our meter is going to read 0.098 volts instead. If we wanted to report the standard reduction potential for copper, we would need to add the 0.241 volts back in to get 0.339 volts. here's the overall reaction you'll be working with. It can be a challenge to understand the species involved, so let's take a moment to go over the chemistry. Iron 2 is present before the cerium 4 is added from the motorized burette. By monitoring the potential as a function of cerium 4 solution volume, we get a curve like this. Here's a non-standard way to visualize what species are present throughout the titration. Iron 2 is present in the beginning. Here, the vertical size will represent moles. As cerium 4 is added, the amount of iron 2 decreases over time as the iron 2 is converted into iron 3. The cerium 4 reacts with the iron 2 to produce cerium 3. Note that after the equivalence point, there's no more iron 2 for cerium 4 to react with, so it starts to accumulate. Well, how does one even set up this experiment? Let's start with a magnetic stir plate. Place a ceramic tile on top of the stir plate to help keep the temperature of the solution constant. Then, your whey bottle will go on top of that. Next is your stir bar, and then your platinum wire, the reference electrode, and the burette delivery tube. Make sure that none of these items touch each other. After each analysis, you'll want to wipe off any excess solution on the SCE. To do this, gently dab the bottom of the electrode with a Kim wipe rather than roughly scrubbing it. Next, you'll add 1 milliliter of the fed solution. Then, add sulfuric acid solution such that the electrode is immersed in liquid. Now you can turn on the stir plate, but don't forget to open the vent. The signals will be collected using the computer and potentiometer as discussed earlier. There are several possible connections on the back of the device. There's a place for the reference electrode, a BNC cable where the platinum wire will connect, an automatic temperature correction, which we don't need, and then there's the record port. Here, the meter sends measurements out to the computer. Connect the black wire from the DAC to this port. That is if you want data. On a practical note, the computer program you'll be working with stops the titration when large changes in potential occur. This is to allow the solution more time to mix. When the system does go into manual mode, wait about 1 second before adding more titrant. There are some potential problems that could occur in this experiment. Avoid noise in your measurements by preventing the electrodes from touching anything. Noise could also be introduced if the wires from the DAC touch the wires of the burette motor driver. If the burette delivery tube is above the solution, then your titration curves will have steps, because titrant is being added in discrete chunks. Keep the burette delivery tube in the solution. Iron 2 solutions oxidize when exposed to air. Try not to mix air into the solution while it's in the flask. Use a pipette to agitate the solution rather than inverting it to mix it. Don't assume that the unknowns you receive are well mixed. For example, the solution could have sat out on a shelf for a while after it was prepared. It could develop a density gradient, and you'll end up drawing liquid out that doesn't represent the sample. Note that the unknown cerium solution can be mixed by inverting it 3 times. The burette should be rinsed with your unknown solution before you put your unknown solution in it, and also at the end of each lab period. To do this, put a small amount of the cerium solution into the burette. Pick up the entire burette assembly, invert it, and then expel the solution. Do this 3 times. Let's make sure you know how to make solutions. Here's how analytical chemists make solutions. First, you'll start with a clean vessel. Second, you fill the vessel halfway with the solvent you'll be using. Then, add the solid. Sonication can help difficult solids dissolve. Next, solvent is added up to the calibration mark on the vessel. Then, to ensure the solution is mixed, the cap is affixed and the vessel is inverted 3 times. Again, don't do this with your fed solution. In terms of safety, it's worth mentioning that no chemicals ever go in the sink. Chemicals you no longer have a use for go in containers labeled ULM, which stands for unwanted lab material. When working with acids, you could potentially hurt yourself. The heat of solvation of acid in water is high, which can cause some dangerous situations. Adding acid to water can minimize accidents. So chemists have a saying, add acid to water like you oughter, add water to acid, get blasted. If for some reason you do get acid on your skin, rinse your skin thoroughly and alert a TA or instructor. When you hear the term formality, you might think of a formal situation like a formal dance. Chemists use this term to describe solutions. For example, consider a 0.1 molar sodium chloride solution. We know that this strong electrolyte completely dissociates, and so we assume that the concentration of sodium chloride is 0 molar. But the concentration of the sodium ions is 0.1 formal, and the concentration of the chloride ions is 0.1 formal. When referring to the concentration of an electrolyte, formality should be used to indicate this complete dissociation. Molarity is used for non-electrolyte solutions. More relevant to this lab, when you see one formal sulfuric acid, know that it's a reference to the three species that could exist in solution. One of our overarching goals is to prepare you for the workplace by helping you think and work like a professional. A rookie might use a spatula to remove chemicals from a reagent bottle, but a good chemist would pour a small amount of the chemical into a clean receptacle and draw from there. A rookie might put a pipette right into a stock solution, while a professional chemist just wouldn't. Professionals know that cleanup is an integral part of lab work. They set aside time to clean up, while a rookie keeps on plugging away right up until the bell. It's time to bug out, so thanks for watching.